Hello, I'm going to tell you about how to use linked data by hacking OWL instead of using reasoners. Whether or not that is unreasonable is probably up to you to decide. But before we begin, I just want you to reflect a bit about the fact that the descriptions of all the data we have are just maps, and as you know, the map is not the territory. So there is this sort of conundrum about how long the coast of Britain is, and depending on how you measure, it can be not too long or infinite. It really matters at which scale you're measuring things. And it's the same thing with the terms in the vocabularies we use, whether they're coarse-grained or fine-grained. And by definition, the data is sort of constricted to the way the usage was conceived when you collected the data, and that's something that you have to keep in mind when you talk about linked data and various vocabularies and how they work together or do not work together. So with that in mind, how far is Sweden from the semantic web? Well, from a spelling distance algorithm perspective, not too far perhaps, but in practice, what we're doing at the National Library of Sweden is that we're sort of betting everything on linked data right now. And this talk is about hedging our bets when we do that. Because we went into production last year with the system that has gotten rid of Mark 21 at its core. We have a system which is a union catalogue, so all the libraries in Sweden are dependent upon this system and work in this system. And it is now fully based on linked data, so all the data we have in the catalogue is real linked data, depending on your definition of real. And it also builds upon BibFrame. From a logical perspective, everything in here is RDF, and the vocabulary that we do have. By the way, I use the term vocabulary and ontology interchangeably here. I tend to think of using vocabulary as a way of signaling that I'm using ontologies rather informally and not importing them into Protégé and expecting reasoners to work upon them. But that's, I mean, RDFS schema and the web ontology language defined classes and properties. From a technical perspective, underneath everything is stored as JSON LD in named graph or documents, depending on what words you prefer. And all the code we write is sort of just hacking on that JSON. We don't actually use a triple store in the system. We have Elasticsearch indexes, and we use some Postgres with the JSON support. And we use the JSON as is in the JavaScript-based editing interface, and so on and so forth. We do base everything in the structures that we have on BibFrame, which we decided to align with because we began the project and began structuring and transforming our Mark 21 data before BibFrame 2 had arrived. I think we even started before BibFrame 1 was published. But we needed our structure so that they fit into the design of BibFrame 2. Mainly because we have so many workflows and notions in place which are contingent on thinking in Mark 21. So for better or worse, we're not too far from those structures yet. I see you, Karen Carl. But what we did in practice was that we defined an application vocabulary, which is just a way of saying that we defined the vocabulary for our own purposes, and we really didn't think that it would be something that anybody else should use. It mapped with equivalences or sub-property subclasses to BibFrame 2, and we extended that where we needed. And in doing so, we also sort of kept track of which terms in other vocabularies were similar to the terms we had, so that we would have some possible future interoperability. But this really depends on how people use linked data today. And one thing I really thought about calling the vocabulary 927 to sort of signal that I know I'm doing this, and everybody is doing this, or if they don't do this, they mix vocabularies together, but then they still have to use more or less 14 vocabularies. So it's a sort of a possible problem with linked data today. And the first sort of mapping attempt that we did, which we actually have deployed right now, is to generate a JSON-LD context, which is derived from the mappings, the equivalences to BibFrame 2 and the other vocabularies, because we use scheme.org terms for details on persons, and we use SCOS terminology. Apart from the subclasses of concepts in BibFrame 2, we sort of mix that together. So we have a JSON-LD context where you can actually see our data as BibFrame 2 data with a combination of things. And this could be construed as an application profile if you want to see it like that. And since I think it is that, as you said, Karen and Tom, it is an application profile. But there are problems with that. The proprio prefixes may or may not be a problem, depending on how much you like prefixes and reading turtle. But the real problem goes back to the map analogy. It's a problem of granularity and concept alignment, of course, but that's impossible to solve anyway. So this is an example of the granularity differences between, in this case, BibFrame and schema.org, where schema.org is much simpler, much flatter, much less mark-like. But there are possible uses in the more sort of qualified structures that you have in BibFrame 2, not only to carry over data from ARC21, but possibilities of adding details around the publication activity itself. So it depends on how you want to use the data. And we really, I try to think of this as something possibly useful. It's just that right now, for our purposes, we haven't really developed the means to utilize the flexibility that is inherent in RDF, especially if you enhance it with something more potent, like possibly OWL. But we're working on making things more fluent and flexible in our system to handle reading data that is not published as BibFrame and publishing data, for instance, as schema.org data. Because the web, the linked data web, has not yet agreed upon the one great vocabulary that everybody should use. And we want to use it right now anyway. So we want to use data from other national libraries, we want to use Wikidata, and we also want to cooperate with other agencies and organizations locally in Sweden who are exploring what linked data is and how it can be used. And this requires some kind of mapping technology. And there are uses in place. Many people use Sparkle construct queries to sort of map certain triples to other triples from one system to another. And there are regular extract, transform, load pipelines everywhere, which is sort of how we always done it in libraries. We just import and export data and transform it on the way and align them and hack away at that. But the sort of simple or more simple specification level where we should just say what we have done is often missing. I mean, if you have an XSLT transform sheet, it's hard to specify what it does without just fully explaining what it does, and then it gets extremely complex, and you don't really know when it becomes too complex for anybody else to understand how your mapping works. So I still think that something simpler and using RDFS and OWL is useful here, though I don't think that inference and OWL reasoning is the one solution to that. But meanwhile, on the semantic web, not necessarily the linked data web, but the more semantic web, there is no reasoning in sight yet. I think that most of the times today, we talk about just linked data. We sort of, sometimes we add OWL assertions as a form of structured documentation, but consumers of linked data, especially Google, they don't consume schema.org even as JSON-LD, they just consume it as JSON, it's just structured data. If you publish data which inherits from schema.org, they don't parse that, they don't follow any reasoning on that logic. The same thing with the DCAT application profile applications that I've seen so far. I've asked some if they could sort of read our vocabulary and extract the terms they need, and they cannot. And there is no practice around that at all right now. And linked data right now is pretty much a raw data format. It's much more potent than just XML or JSON because it's linked, it's graphs, it has semantics which are lacking or overly complex in other data structures. But I still think that something more powerful is possible. So why this confusion of tongues in the linked data world? Well, OWL reasoners aren't very good at what we need from them today. There are different reasoning algorithms, more or less complex. I would not sit down in an afternoon and just implement an OWL reasoner. And the ones that exist, which are very good, produce like 10,000 triples from my 20 triples. And then I have to filter that out again. And I still miss the 10,001 triple that it didn't infer. So it's not necessarily what we need. And I like to think about OWL more as a set of guidelines than strict rules. So we hack away at that. And what we've done is that we've used these tools to map between properties. And especially we're trying to make things more capable of handling different granularity levels. So I call this approach the target vocabulary maps. There is an implementation here. It's just more or less a prototype. We haven't put this into production yet. I just wanted to see how few lines of code I could write to do this, which I had in my head for like 4 years. You don't have to read this. This is a very informal definition of what it does. It just tries to, it's contingent upon you saying what target vocabulary or possibly combination of terms that you want to have. And then you look at the mappings that are in place in the vocabularies and you see if they lead to the terms that you want. And once you've done that, you have a sort of lookup table, and then you can use that to put linked data in and get other linked data out. So it looks like this, and this is what the tool does. It takes with a bib frame data, and it churns through that mapping. And this is very efficient because it's sort of the table is already calculated, so it's basically just a set of dictionary lookups. And it turns it into either Dublin Core terms or schema.org terms. And that's not necessarily a bad thing at all, I think. I hope that this will catch on. It doesn't really matter if it doesn't, because we're using this ourselves. That's the main purpose of doing this. And then I think that it probably is a good idea to talk about, because I think using OWL reasoners today isn't happening. And using raw linked data doesn't necessarily lead to the semantic web. And being in a semantic web conference, this might be a good thing. And it works on the simplest level. It's just mapping term one to term two. So you can have a FOV document, which is an RDFS resource, and a Dublin Core title, which is some kind of label. So you can get that out. That's a piece of cake. And then for the varying granularities, this is where it gets a bit interesting. I use the OWL property chain axiom and sort of ties things together to say that, well, from this structured value, you can pick up the value inside, and if it matches the sub class of identifier bound to ISBN class in bib frame, you get a simple schema.org ISBN property out. That's a creative use of OWL, which I've seen reasoners being able to actually produce. Although, in fact, and this is just a detail, the property chain axiom doesn't allow you to use data type properties. But in OWL full, OWL object properties and data type properties aren't disjoint. So it works anyway, if you squint, and they do. And then I use the similar approach to dig at the parts of the publication activity to get out the publisher and the date published. So that's also pretty straightforward. And then it comes to the last example, where I actually throw in the old ghosts of reification into the process again. because there are structures like qualified relations where you provide the actual property through another property. So here you have a contribution event where an agent has a role. But by saying that the contribution is a statement-like structure, and the agent is an object-like property, and the role is a predicate-like property, I tell my own hackish code that will produce the creator relation from that information. So owl reasoners can't do this, but hacking at will can do this. I think it's very important as well to say that if this is a viable approach, it should have limitations. So it's quite reasonable, once I map this out even further and specify it, to say that it shouldn't really do error correction. You should do that in another step. Should probably not do things like following broader relations and normalizing values in concept schemes. That's another thing. So this is just trying to raise the bar a bit to use OWL to be able to use more generic code to produce something than just something very complex like an XSLT or a Sparkle construct. And you can never get away from the philosophical traps of whether a person is a concept and things like that. But you could probably conflate them in by subclassing both of them, and then you can get out what you want. But aren't I, am I not then promoting OWL without taking responsibility for the consequences of using OWL? Well, yes, I am. And I think that's fine, because I don't think that OWL will sort of become something on the web scale. I think we will be more or less isolated in our own context for quite some time now. And of course, the open world assumption is dangerous, and the RDFS domain and range properties don't mean what people think they mean. And never use OWL same as undiluted from other people's data, because you will have indigestion or worse. It's really, really problematic to use that property. But you could, in an application vocabulary, of course, map that into something like SCoS exact match and just cheat away from the problem. And we've done that in certain cases. So application vocabularies is sort of a semantic encapsulation. And the thing that I think is important is that if you publish data using an application vocabulary, you have a URI for your idiomatic use of the title notion, for instance, which is a bit different from application profiles. So that's a discussion we can have. And for us at the National Library of Sweden, the next steps is to use this implementation and the approach of this in production by being able to rework our loading and transformation pipelines and get at the data that we want a bit less idiosyncratically for every source, where we right now have transform scripts in place, so that we can consume different shapes of data, and also so that we can publish data for users who want to have just oblinkor terms and schema org terms. And that works right now, but we really need to put something like profile negotiation in place in order for people to ask for that and get what they want. So I think that there is something else than just staying with the ways that we are using raw data right now and waiting for OWL to happen. I think that we can use OWL a bit creatively and hope that we won't have to deal with some kind of nuclear situation where OWL assertions sort of go awry on the web of artificial intelligence, and that would be nasty, I guess. But I don't think that will happen. I'm not so afraid of OWL reasoners that I think that they will break my data or break the web. So I encourage you to check out the implementation if you want, or just look at this presentation again, and that's it.
Thanks, Niklas, for raising the bar for us and making us see what got the job done for you. What do you think? Other questions, comments? Tiziana.
So, Niklas, if I understood, when you speak about mapping something, if you speak about mapping data or mapping vocabularies to produce an application for vocabularies, I think that you can introduce something that is local. So it probably is never possible to match exactly a concept or an entity. Start again. So do you think that it's possible to declare to the world that this is your usage of this concept in your local data, so that the declaration can be shared and better understood?
Yes, I do think that. I'm not betting on that, but I think that. And I'm not betting on that because this is a way to show that it is simple to do that. And if nobody else catches on that and this doesn't become a practice, we can still publish what others need or ingest what others produce using this application vocabulary. But it would be very, I would love for application vocabularies expecting this approach to work for RDF consumers, and that would raise the bar in practice. So that might actually work web scale.
Anybody else with a question? Up there is, can you go there? Thanks. Some sports towards the end of the conference.
As I see it, the main problem in the acceptance of the outcome of all reasoners is that they produce uncurated data. And so as I see it, because all the all reasoners you tested are doing too well in producing uncurated data, you made one that is doing much less, but still the data that comes out of it is uncurated. Does that produce problems in your house?
Bad data won't go away through reasoning alone. We need to clean the data. And that's why I sort of put in this, I think that error correction and cleaning up is probably out of scope for this thing, this approach, just because if I added it into the approach in the same step, it would get too complex and it wouldn't catch on. So I still think that people publishing raw data should curate their own data. It's sort of an environmentally friendly way of publishing data.
Okay. If there are no further questions, I'd suggest we thank Niklas again. Thanks.